Hello and welcome back to Blacker Couch Reviews. I'm your host, Christina. We're back to discuss the seventh episode in the third season of The Bear entitled Legacy, written by Christopher Storr, directed once again by Joanna Kahlo. I thought for some reason this season was eight episodes and it's 10, which makes more sense to me. I'm not sure why I thought it was eight episodes, other than I think the first season was eight. Right? That's neither here nor there. We get a lot more time to develop these characters, which I feel has been the trajectory for this season thus far. It's a lot of self-reflecting, a lot of the grind of the restaurant, which eventually becomes routine. So it's more about the atmosphere and what's going on with the individuals, then it's about its market success, which makes sense when I find out that the creator of this series, Christopher Storr, only planned three seasons and Hulu or FX was like, no, I'll give us four. So this seems, unlike the last two seasons, kind of like the pace of a very busy dinner shift. It's more like the time we do spend actually throughout the prepping for the big event. I like it personally. I can see, I haven't really went out and looked at the opinions online about this season too much because I want to kind of not allow it to reflect anything in my review. However, like Mimi said last week, it doesn't seem as if this season has a lot of, like, a lot of people are not talking about it despite the fact that it has been nominated. So I don't know if people feel as if the show, with its more artsy way of storytelling, is simply not what they've been expecting. So they're having a bit of, you know, what their expectations were versus what they got. And I can understand that as someone who's been in a different show where I did not respond kindly, or it took me a while to respond kindly, whichever the case, to a change in pace or tone that's radically different from what was prior. But I don't think it's that radically different. I think it's just more mulling. And more of an exploration of the business in itself and the genre, right, of the worker bee, and in particular, the restaurant or food industry that services the public, but is often the most underpaid, the most stressed, dealing with a lot of failure over success. And how that can impact the people that are involved. But it's also about the growth of this particular restaurant and how it evolves from the emotional trauma throughout generations of a family until the healing power of Sydney walks through the door. But finds herself being a bit of a beacon in a storm. I don't even know if that's the right terminology, but she is able to be just that perfect assist. She grows in the chaos of this place, but now she might, like a story when Ashford was telling Naomi Nagata on the show The Expanse, that sometimes you outgrow your family. But maybe it's the wrong family she thinks she's outgrowing. Maybe it's the expectations versus what, but no, I think it's the latter. Unlike Naomi, I think she may need to and have to and able to continue her journey. And we get that line in this episode, life is a journey, the journeys that they take you, some of the worst things that happen lead to some of the better things that happen. And I think that Sydney may be in one of those curving roads moments where her path may diverge from what has become her adopted family. I wonder if some of the loyalty from the staff is due to Carmi, or is it due to the legacy that is Mikey, which was another topic that came up, which is an interesting question because we do see those coming into work where we actually got some names to some faces where they look up at a poster of Mikey and they're like, we're doing this for you. So is that honoring of, despite the hecticness and the way in which the restaurant is ran? Is that accepted because the spirit of Mikey lives on in this place? But then we have Carmi, who is still attending, which is a good thing, AA meetings, or is it called AA or Al-Anon? Alcoholic Anonymous? Yeah, it's called AA. I said Al-Anon. But I like this section a lot because he's thinking about Claire nonstop and he just has allowed a lot of time to pass before apologizing for his actions and his words that night. And there is another man that's there talking about how his wife is now sober and she apologized, but he's still stuck in the mud. He's still living with the damage that she inflicted upon him due to her addiction. And while she can get sober and have clarity, he is still dealing with the weight of that. He feels a little resentful that she's kind of, oh, well, you apologize. So you're supposed to be given off scot-free. And then another woman talks about how apologizing can be a struggle, especially when you allow yourself to not do it immediately. And the longer it festers, the more your other insecurities and mistakes compound it, and then that apology becomes buried within you and it will never erupt. And Carmi wonders if this is something he's allowing himself to do, that this unspoken apology is just going to continue to cause him to spiral further out of control. Although I feel like we've seen the extent other than his continued, well, enabled state of mind. But you need to allow the apology out. Because if you don't, then it's going to continue to eat away at you. And so Carmi is in that mindset. He's also feeling as if he doesn't need to run anything by Sydney because her opinion regarding the menu isn't of importance. Now, I'm going to give Carmi the benefit of the doubt here because he also has a way of not saying what's on his mind. And I thought Natalie had a line that was really just oddly placed when she goes outside and sees Sydney standing there. She lays her head on her shoulder, and then after having a brief discussion, if she needs anything, she says, "Sign the document, Sydney." What you say? So is Carmi feeling that without her continued partner, I mean, he has to think about that, but I keep talking about every time I want to give him the benefit of the doubt here. I keep talking myself into the fact that Carmi doesn't seem to care about the more legal paperwork thing. That's why Sugar was hired in the first place. That's insignificant to him. So I can't see him being too caught up in the fact that she hasn't signed. But maybe, just maybe, without her agreeing to the partnership, he doesn't feel as if she can make any decisions. But you would think if that's the case, if you want this person on your team and you're feeling as if they are trepidatious due to all of the signs that they are telling you, "I'm trepidatious," not to mention the actual words. Yeah, wouldn't you be not undercutting her authority even more, but deciding to be collaborative and showing her what a benefit of that partnership would be? Especially when you know that you are not the most liked person in this kitchen. In a lot of ways, why am I thinking about his name right now? I'm blanking. Richie, I still feel, are stuck back in the same pattern. Richie now with Mikey, and now Carmi becoming the new Mikey, except his addiction is not pills. It's the control he feels over this restaurant. And the more his life feels without control and chaotic, the tighter his reins become on everything that's happening at the restaurant. And all of Sydney's ideas are shut down when she tries to offer any idea on the menu. And he isn't even cognizantly aware that he is undermining her. Don't be a bitch. With Carmine, there's nothing more frustrating than knowing that you need help but refusing to take that step. And I know it's easier said than done, but it is frustrating for the people that are around you. You know, it seems like he's doing all of the right things. He's making the right moves, but it's all a facade. So while he's going to AA, he isn't, and he's internalizing, unlike Richie, who verbalizes a lot of what he's trying to learn from his own therapy sessions due to his anger management. He's the exact opposite. While Richie's growth is causing him to be more self-aware of the mood in his life, Carmi has no awareness. Which leads to that nice conversation they do have with him and Marcus, who is trying to live in Carmi's shadow as well. He's reading his book. They're not doing much with Marcus this season, but it's fine. He's not one of the main characters, and I think that we get enough of him each episode. But he does sometimes feel like the adopted child of Carmi and Sydney. He's like, "Dad, I'm going through your stuff. And I see this. What does this mean? What does this mean? Did you really meet all these people?" But they all spoke, these older chefs, about their legacy, and about legacy is for them how, you know, you teach one person one thing, or you go to one restaurant and you make an impact, and then someone learns from that and goes someone else and starts impacting that, or their young people see that and then start taking that on and so forth. And the cycle continues itself. So you're constantly reinventing the wheel, but tradition is underlined due to all of the legacies that come before it. But Carmi would need to get rid of all the bad shit before he can even consider what his legacy would be. Typically, Sydney only wants to think about right now and not the future, which has crippled her, because she should be thinking about her future as it's pressing ever closer to where she's going to need to make a decision. And an emotional decision at that. And that makes it even harder. I know that she feels resentment for Carmi the way he is treating her. But she's also, I feel like when we saw in season one, she dealt with a lot, like a lot, and still was able to make an impression, was able to turn Tina and the rest of this team around. And the fact that she did that for these people is the reason why Adam Shapiro from Ever, who we thought was poaching last time, actually this time really is poaching. I don't think he was poaching last time. I think he really was complimenting her. But when you stand back and think about it, of course, she would be seen as a miracle worker when you walk into the Bear. You saw what the place used to be. Yes, you have Carmi. They all know who Carmi is, but they know that there's something lacking about him. Sydney is that missing link. She's the other side of the coin that brings the more heart to Carmi's, to his neuroticism. Is that the right word? And so he's looking back and like, look at what you did to Richie. Even Carmi for the most part is kept in check. He is putting out good food, right? They are putting out good food. But his favorite dish is something he knew wasn't Carmi's. He sees all of her potential. Look what you did with Tina. Look what you did with this place, right? Why would I not let you come into my kitchen and do whatever it is that you want to do? Here's a bonus, enough money to make a good career, because you already proved the impossibility with your current position. And he can see, and he even says, look, I'm not doing this behind the scenes, but I'm gonna go ahead and open my own restaurant now that Ever is closing. You know, I would have stayed there forever, but now I have just been pushed into finally taking the position of leadership that I always knew I could do. And that happens a lot. I'm one of those people. I know I can do a leadership position. I just have no interest in pursuing it unless I was like pushed into it. But he's also someone where you're so happy at where you are and working for who you working for, and you're inspired by them. Why leave? But now that he is no longer working for that, he can't go back to working for some other person. He probably has a legacy he wants to carry on from Ever, from working with her. And so he's opening his own restaurant. He's already got backers from Ever because they know what he can do. And he needs to get this moving rather quickly. So would you like to be CDC Sydney? And I will talk to Carmi about it. And she says, because he wanted to know if she'd be interested. And despite her hesitancy, she is. R-E-S-P-E-C-T, find out what it means to me. As she should be. She is not being afforded the respect. And she is continuing to take on more and more positions outside of her own position. And then she's not even given her due in that position. And we know that she loves to cook. So to have her... which it was the most complimented dish from one of the most successful chefs out there that's on par with Carmi. Hell yeah, I'd be like, look at all my talent and it's not being at all highlighted here. It's being taken for granted, if we're being honest. But there is a love and investment that she has here and the inspiration of working for Carmi that made her better at what she could do, because he also was the one that pushed her in the position and forced her to learn Coach K and how to talk to people and give them a pep talk when Richie, unfortunately, due to his own personal insecurities and trauma, is struggling. And she's there to catch him when he falls. And I appreciated that he at least thanked her for doing that. She gets a voicemail from her dad who's talking about the sound on the radiator. He's like, who am I supposed to call? You know you got that too when you live with... I don't even live with my mom. I haven't lived with my mom in, what, 2 decades. And she still will call me about who to call about a lot of things that she just doesn't want to deal with, or it's easier if you deal with. She's all the time, she wants to look up something. She has a computer in her house, she has internet, she has a phone with internet. She's like, why don't you just go online and look at this site? She can do it herself. She's like, but it's so fast when you do it. So once again, those little familial moments is what really makes this show such a gem, an underappreciated gem probably at times. I could see this season would be one of those times, because it's a lot of talking. It's a lot of people saying how they feel. I do like the naturalization in the dialogue, like how you cut people off when they're talking, but you don't acknowledge what they're saying. You're just like, oh shit, what? Or fuck? Or what the fuck? Because Fock had a lot of that this episode. Which we get introduced to a new Fock. I guess they're just going to have guest stars. I don't know who this guy is, so if he's supposed to be important. But he's the uncle. Didn't catch his last name. But he talks about a haunting is like grabbing a cable. The funniest part about that scene was the what the fucks. I did laugh when they went to Natalie's office and they're like, hey, we need seafoods. Oh, how did you know that? Are you psychic? Is the pregnancy making you psychic? And then they're like, can we come with you? Absolutely not. No, you cannot come with me. They're like two little kid brothers that are always talking and doing the most. They are a charming bit of the restaurant. And because they are the only ones that seem to just be living their life, their best life, I wouldn't want the show without them, even if sometimes the humor doesn't particularly hit for me. I did like the two guys coming in helping Ibram. I forgot their names, but they had me cracking up. Like, no mayonnaise, no silverware. It's all over the parking lot. Somebody got to clean that shit up. No reason to have silverware, which I absolutely agree. If you eat, if this is a sandwich shop, you will not be getting silverware. Talking about, can I get mayonnaise? He's like, I gave him mayonnaise, but told him to go home and put it on his sandwich to ruin it. Oh, that cracked me up. But they had their system. I like that word came back. It's almost like the old and the new, right? The bear could not work out a system for the new beef in the window. And that beef be making money. He's like, it smell good in here. Well, it'd be really shitty if it smelled bad. I like them. They feel like authentic Chicagoans. There was another scene with the fax I thought was funny, but I might not be recalling it correctly. Maybe Mimi catches it in the feedback. So Abrams finally got a smile on his face. He finally has the work that he, or the help that he needs. They're having fun while they do it. Yeah, it's weird how the beef is becoming increasingly more successful, whereas the bear is not really successful. It is commercially successful, but not financially successful. And even commercially, you know, the way stars can rise and fall in the restaurant business, it really is all hanging on this review, which we haven't heard anyone discuss yet, because there's really, I mean, other than worrying about it, it is what it is. But I can see without it being a financial success and then it becoming a negative commercial success, that the bear may in fact not be able to. I hadn't questioned this until this episode, that it may not be, I don't think it's sustainable. Honestly, the menu changing every day makes it unsustainable. It feels like a rich man's plaything experience, like something you would do, like a pop-up restaurant, more so than a long-term thought-out franchise. But I do think that the experiences here at the Bear has transformed all of the people that work here. So whether it fails, that's not going to be like, yeah, of course, everyone wants to be a Michelin star best restaurant out there. But sometimes you can just be a good restaurant. You can have sustainability. And that is what the beef is, what the beef has been. So I think it'd be really ironic for season 4 that the bear drops itself and integrates fully back into the beef. Now, I can hear the Sydney haters in the commentary section being like, well, it was her idea in the first place, the yada, 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 yada. I think that Sydney does want the things that she wants. I think she thought she was going to be able to partner and find that partnership with Carmi. And there's nothing wrong with that, because Carmi naturally would be someone would have that and did have that exact same goal. I feel like people really be acting like Carmi was dragged by his ball strap into this idea, which is ridiculous. Despite his trepidation, he did want to pursue it. It just came with having to tackle, as we saw episode 1, the bear in the cage. And this continues to be that journey. Back to Abram real quick. When he was outside with that cigar and there was all these random ass people around the fox as they just talkity talk talk. Who are you? Natalie is asked several times in this episode is if she is okay. She has a conversation with Richie. She's also told a lot of pregnancy stories about what it's like and what it feels like leading up to, and how during the actual labor it's either ridiculously chill and you're watching TV or you're in a parking lot and your husband is landing later on tonight and you have no one around you and your entire family is now at work with their phones in their lockers.
Oh dear, we are in trouble.
Richie recalls that prior to their child being born, that his wife, she was mad at him. So he remained at her side all day, which she was like, oh, that's sweet. Is it? Y'all seem to have had a very fraught relationship. But then and he had just gotten back from this trip with Mikey, which was really fun, and he cries over it, but that was the sacrifice he made. I think prior, there was a scene where it looked like he knocked on the door and he was like, Mikey, and me included, was like, oh, is this when he found his body? Not recalling that didn't Mikey shoot himself on the bridge? Pretty sure that's how he passed away. So Richie would not have found his body. So we don't have to add that on there. And I'm glad because we didn't get any of that flashback. He's thinking about his daughter and how they're moving on and how, like, they're both stuck in a glue trap, Carmi and Richie. And if only they could just unstick themselves. But then you have the parallel of Sydney and Carmi as she's in that dumpster taking out all of her aggressions and frustrations on those boxes. Someone should be breaking down those boxes, though. What is up with that? Lastly, I think topically is we get the backstory of Sweeps because the other fop comes over, asks, he's back from winery school, and he asks him, you know, what's up? Are you good to handle this? Like, I know you had something happening with your career. Just, you know, I kind of know the details. I know you had a bad test, but he explains that he was young. He was good. He was always skinny, though, and he wanted to bulk up. Someone offered him some shit that was going to help him. He took it twice. It showed up in a piss test. End of his career. Then he goes to a dark place, but he gets uplifted a little bit by being told, you know, I used to follow your career. You know, you were really good. Despite what you wanted not working out, you did find some purpose in life. Because as he's talking, he's like, yeah, and then I found this place. And that's where you had the cross conversation again. I liked it personally because it felt more real. And he's just like, I'm happy for you. You know, I'm glad this is how things changed for you. We know he was homeless at one point, so he did go to a very dark place. And now here he is finding new skills and a new way to find a passion. I like that. And they followed up on the Sweep story. You know, we got like a little bit that he used to play baseball, but we get a little bit more here. So I feel like that's going to be how the season continues to build, is Sydney contemplating whether or not she's actually going to sign this agreement. Natalie is now going into labor. Is that going to affect her decision at all? Carmi, he's still, I think he's probably, while he's able to tell, particularly Marcus and Sydney, I noticed that he's able to voice that there are things that he needs to course correct in his life, which is a step in the right direction, right? There is no action on that. And that's where I don't see that he's developed as much. Would Claire even accept the apology at this point? I personally would not. Even if I, Claire might. She's loved him her entire life. So what's another couple of weeks? What's another couple of months? You know, what's another year? But I do think that you can wait too long. And I think that would be a lesson to be learned. I don't want it to be learned in any tragic way, like she dies or anything. But yeah, that's where his headspace is. And I can see if you were a Sydney Carmi shipper, how that would be very bothersome for you. But I already stated once, if you thought that his emotions were just going to dampen and then he would just twirl around and realize, oh my gosh, Sydney, you're the most beautiful person in this world. Even though he did compliment her outfit, said, you look nice, which she did. I loved everything about that outfit. It was super cute. It looked like she was like a Japanese schoolgirl. I'm too old to try to pull that off. Can't do it, but super cute. Would love to do it myself. Maybe I'll send it pic to Maya and be like, hey, do this. You're young enough. Do this look. I don't know if she's still in that phase yet, though. But, yeah. It feels as if they were best friends. And they're still friends, but they're not. I even feel like they're family. They're just, they're not on the same page of, like, Sydney needs something that is going to envelope her in the talent and in the acceptance that she's kind of been searching for. And I think because she's so accepted here too, to leave that behind, like I said before, it's not just a transactional or a business decision. It's an emotional one. That's all my thoughts on the episode. We do have feedback, so let's hop into the mailbag.
Mail, motherfucker! What up, Stina? It's Mimi. This is my feedback for The Bear, episode 7 of season 3. I watched this a long time ago and I completely forgot what it was about, and I completely forgot to send feedback, and I was finna go into 8 because I saw your schedule, and then I'm like, wait a second, I don't remember talking about 7. And then I looked back and I didn't record anything. So I was like, okay, well, the only thing I absolutely remember was the fact that Sugar was looking like she was going into labor in the parking lot of that, I don't know, restaurant version of Costco. Never heard of that in Chicago, but I mean, I don't tend to go to surplus stores for restaurants, so I feel like it was a made up store, but you know, never mind. So I just had to watch it again. I guess the first thing I want to say is, I don't know if you've ever had an Italian beef. They're called Italian beef, but people just call them a beef dipped. I know I had never heard of it because I was born in the South, and that's where I lived for my adolescence. And then when I was it was the summer before 10th grade, my mom decided she was going to move us to the Midwest. So there was a lot of things I didn't grow up with. Like, even now, like, people in Illinois call sodas pop, especially people from Chicago. I still can't. It doesn't feel right to me. So I don't do it. It feels like if I said it, I would be an imposter. So I still say soda, but I can tell you an Italian beef dipped is really good. I don't like hot, spicy stuff, so I don't get any of the hot peppers. And I don't particularly like sweet peppers. So it's either sweet or hot peppers. But I usually, like, if I get it dipped, if they, when they were saying dry, that means they don't want it dipped. But usually it comes just dipped. Like, you don't really have to say it. If you're in the city, you would just say dry. But I only know that because Darren. I didn't know what dip was until I got a sandwich. And I was like, this is kind of wet. And then Darren told me what it was. But I got it without it being dipped. And I didn't like it as much. So definitely get it dipped. Unless you're one of those people who don't like soggy bread, then don't do it. Because you're going to be cringed. But it's really good. So I love seeing, I've been calling him Abraham, but I think it's Ibrahim. Seeing him like thriving with those other guys. It's weird though, because like, why did they leave in the first place? Was it because, were they in the restaurant when Mikey died and Carmi took over? Because I don't remember seeing them last season. And did they leave because they didn't want to be a part of this fancy restaurant? Or did they leave before that? Because I remember the first time we saw dude was at the beginning of this season. So I'm curious to know why they left the beef in the first place. But, I mean, they still got it. It must be like, you know, second nature to them. Because they picked up right where they left off. And Abraham was right where he needed to be, doing what he does. And he was living his best life. I love seeing it. I'm not going to lie. I love being right, because I said something about this and I know you don't remember anything. And generally speaking, I don't remember either, but I remember you like dismissing me talking. They were like, they don't care about that. I understand what gentrification is, but when you're in a community like this, like, I don't know if you've ever lived in like the inner city or been in like an urban. I know you said you're from Ohio, Christina, but I don't know the, like, if it's like a suburb part, but I can tell you them Chicago people can be petty, and I could see them feeling like they were being gentrified. I'm not saying they would do some dirty shit, but I could see it happening. And more importantly, the people that are in the neighborhood, I would feel like, not Carmi necessarily, but Richie, Natalie, Abraham, all of those people that have been working at that place and they know the neighborhood and they know the people in the area, they would want to make sure that they didn't take away something that they, you know, traditionally care about, or, you know, that they might have utilized for their lunch breaks or whatever the case was. So I'm just happy that they felt like it was important enough to preserve that part of their, you know, family legacy, which, pun intended, because that was the name of the episode. I just wanted to throw that out there. Anywho, I'm drawing a blank on the dude's name, but the guy who was talking to one of the Falk brothers about his baseball career. I remember like in season one, them like bringing it up. But, like, that was really all they did. They never talked about it. So, I don't know. I enjoyed that conversation. I like seeing different people interact. Probably because I'm sick of seeing Carmi interact with Sydney and talking to her crazy. Or more important, or I guess more realistically, what it seems like he's, like, ignoring her. And I don't know if that's really what he's like, if that's the right like description, but like the shortness, like the acknowledging her verbally, but not even like stopping what you're doing to look up and look her in the face. I don't know. That's my biggest pet peeve. It's like, you could have not spoke. You could have just pretended like I wasn't there, because to me, just saying hey to someone, or in their case, yes, chef, is so superficial and so robotic. It doesn't take a lot of effort. Like, but for you to, like, the fact that he didn't look up made it very easy to dismiss her and like, not listen to what she says. Like, you're changing the menu and you're not even acknowledging her. And he has no idea that she has a whole offer on the table. She hasn't signed any of that paperwork because she clearly has doubts. And you're just adding fuel to the fire. Now, I don't want Sydney to leave the bear because I feel like if she left, they would fall apart. And, you know, she is the glue that's holding everybody together. But I also am on the mindset, fuck him. You know what I'm saying? Like, I feel like, and this is something I've been feeling, and I've been scrolling through TikTok and you know, you caught me right as I went down the rabbit hole where it's a bunch of Palestinians telling black people, basically, you don't support Palestine if you're voting for Kamala Harris. And I'm not here to tell anybody who to vote for, but if you think that Donald Trump cares more about a ceasefire than a Democrat, you're full of shit and you're just talking. Because there's no way. And if you were one of those people who says, well, no, I don't want to vote for Trump, so you're just not going to vote for anybody. Because you can't be that naive. You can waste your vote on a third party, but they're not going to win. And all you're going to do is pull votes away from Democrats, and then Trump's going to win. And I guarantee if he wins, it's going to be worse. Because he doesn't care. And all, honestly, Israel would have to do is offer that motherfucker money. And he'd be like, you know what? Let me send you some guns and some troops. And if you don't think that that motherfucker would do that, you're crazy. But I'm going to get off my soapbox because it's just going to get my blood pressure up. But I feel like this conversation has me thinking about how people expect black women to save them. Like, you dig yourself into a grave. And then we got to be the one to pick up the pieces. And I'm sick of it. And in all honesty, the way Carmi treating Sydney makes me want her to not think of him like that ever. Because you don't deserve her, sir. You can't even have enough fucking decency to apologize to your cousin after belittling him. And apologize to the woman that you said you love. Motherfucker, you... I understand apologizing isn't easy, and Carmi is really not good at it. But it's either you want to apologize because you're sorry or you don't. It ain't no middle. And clearly, you can't be bothered thinking about anybody but yourself right now. And your mind is so laser focused that you can't even acknowledge the people around you. And when Sydney takes her up that offer and you get poached, which is basically what happens, I'm going to be like, good. It's what she deserves. Basically, giving her the opportunity that you said you were going to give her, but you're not giving it to her. And yes, you are the Michelin star person already. Like, you already have one. How is Sydney going to feel like she helped get it if you're not even acknowledging her input? He, like, dismissed her so disrespectfully. Like, he didn't even look her in the face. And that shit boiled my blood. I can't even. And I don't want to sit here and talk about how irritated Carmi made me in that interaction with Sydney. Even the way he picked up his notebook and was like yes chef or something about chef and walked away. Like, he didn't even like acknowledge her on the way out. It just made me so mad. So I don't want to keep griping about it, so I'm gonna leave that there. The other thing was, I guess I always thought they called the Fox because the Fox brothers, because, you know, they were like family, but I guess they have a business because it said Matter of Fox. And I thought that was funny on the back of his sweater, I forget, or his shirt. Dang, I can't remember. It was construction, no, electrician, something like that. And then we got to meet the uncle. I don't know. All of them are weird. And I feel like I would have to, like, if I worked at that restaurant, I would have to get them in small doses. And definitely not two of them, more than two of them at a time. Because if I saw three, absolutely not. I would turn and go the other way. I'm going to need y'all to take shifts, and only two of y'all can be present at a time. The conversation they had with Natalie was hilarious. It's like, oh, is being pregnant making you psychic? She's like, yeah, absolutely. They so fucking stupid. I mean, it's funny, and they are helpful, and they do tend to be sweet at times, especially to Natalie. So I'll allow it. I feel like there's something else I'm forgetting. There was something that you talked about in your last couple of podcasts that I wanted to talk about, but I don't remember. And I really got to stop listening in my car and listen to certain podcasts when I'm not in my car so I can write down notes. But that is whatever it was is gone. So maybe I'll remember after I watch 8. Because I don't know if you know this. I think you think 8 is the last one. But I just seen that there's a 9th episode. So there's 9 total this season. So anyway, I'll end it here. Until next time, love, peace, hair grease, and black girl magic. Queen of the Couch, Mimi out.
Thank you for bringing up the slogan on the back of his shirt. Because I meant to. Matter of fact, that I like that a lot. That's pretty hysterical. And the fact that they're in all type of plumbing, all of those essential need type of services is great. they got a different family member and everything. I like the continuing gag. It hasn't worn itself out. Like I said, even if it doesn't always hit for me. I will say Sydney is half to blame, as much as I agree with you, everything you said about Carmi's treatment of her and continuing to not feel as if she is an essential part of the system. The partnership really isn't a partnership. It's a codependency for both of them. And she admitted herself as much that she's enabling his tyrannical behavior due to the idea that she feels her mentor is the right one, is the one to be listened to, the one to be adhered to, that this is the way to the success that you want. Very much the way he and Joel McHale's character was, and how he would undermine, they didn't even have that type of business. He was just, I think, his CDC or one of his chefs. I'm not sure. But there was a moment where he tasted something and knew that, no, this guy isn't completely right. So the person that you're even following may not have the same vision ultimately that you have. They may help you get there, but it's ultimately your talent that's going to be highlighted and showcased on the plate. And Sydney continuing to do that without, but we saw this as a continuous problem with her, right? We had a moment where she was like, okay, no, you talk to me. But it feels as if more and more as the seasons continue to go on, she hasn't been getting, if anything, everything's going in the opposite direction. Which is why she hasn't signed the agreement. And that it is showing the red flags to everyone else, but Carmi, because Carmi is just oblivious because he, like you said, is very hyper focused on his own particular issues. And this place is simply, like I pointed out before, how he keeps the reins on his own exploding life. But that doesn't do any favors for the people in his life, the most that are being chucked in the mud, like the guy in the AA meeting was talking about. Like, oh yeah, you can just roll off and apologize. Like the same thing with Richie. But like shit was said that can't be unsaid. And now I can't just push that off and be like, oh, everything's cool now and you were just sorry. It's like, no, I'm still dealing with the fallout of that. And you want to be given this kind of free pass for your behavior. In regards to the right to vote and the Palestine matter, I did look into it. I didn't talk about it too much on the podcast for Jones Chronicles, mainly because I'm still, it's a complicated matter. It's one of those things where it is something I am, it comes with a lot of history behind it. So I don't know if I feel comfortable, honestly, making too much commentary on what I really don't know that well, if I'm being honest. I've been, of course, hearing about, but again, that's a long, long, complicated, drawn out history. I did see, particularly because I watched Channel 5, which is a documentary, that is kind of on the boots type of, they go and talk to the people on all sides. They don't pick a side. They're not trying to tell you to pick a side. They're just saying, here's what people are saying. And the one of the things that some were saying, others were co-signing, others were side-eyeing, was that they felt the Black Lives Matters movement should have, I didn't hear anything about Black women in particular, but the Black Lives movement. Now, I'm not going to speak too much on the presidential candidate that is Kamala Harris. Of course, a lot of people are going to find her anyone reasonable is going to find her a more attractive candidate. But ultimately, you know, there might be things that whatever is you're drawing the line, it's you're drawing the line. I am a very strong proponent of everyone has the right to vote or not vote. And if they do vote, they can vote personally. They don't have to vote not to, you know, as you pointed out, was a wasted vote, quote unquote, to vote for a different candidate. I think it stops at the right to vote. And anything past that is someone's personal decision. And I'm not going to influence that way. I could see things about Kamala Harris that isn't attractive as a candidate, just because she's Black and a female doesn't mean that she is up to the job. We don't know. There's a lot of that you could, if you were inclined, to analyze. Again, juxtapose against her component or her opponent. But I think when it comes to politics now, I don't find it rational. I don't find a lot of people are making decisions based on wherever and whatever they feel is their right. What is the right decision? So right or wrong, Black and white, you know, everyone's got their side. Everyone's got their opinion. Some are more, of course, acrimonious than others, but this has been the continued cycle. And honestly, I'm glad that there are people out there that have the energy to be continually invested in even reading up on this, because I have long disengaged, and you keep me updated, and even when you do, I'm just like, I'm still indifferent. You know, I don't know, you know, people are uninformed, unenlightened. It's about who they choose to believe. And I don't know if we can always say that you're being an idiot, not to, at least I personally, you do what you do. But I, without sitting down next to those people and across from the people, I can't personally speak too much about it. And I don't even want to, because I do kind of feel like not my dog, not my fight. Certainly from the sidelines, just being informed, especially as they have brought in the Black Lives Matter movement, I don't think they have the right to, you know, to tell the Black Lives Matter movement what they should do for them. That's kind of where I'm at. I can't have it both ways. I'm not going to tell them how they should feel, but also tell them why they shouldn't feel this way about how they feel. I do think that everyone can't be all encompassing for whatever issue they is, which is why people tend to lean more nowadays to polarization. But I think that's not the correct way, that it needs to be not assimilated, but digested and dissected. But that is neither here nor there. And sometimes I feel like I'm just talking to the wind. Again, you don't watch Rick and Morty, but there is an episode where everyone becomes a hive mind effectively. And then once they're released from the hive mind, everyone are who they are, but they all need to associate their identity by differing. It starts off as characteristics of nipples, but the metaphor there is people need to define themselves here or there and are willing to pursue their side and with justice. And then there's those that are kind of like myself that doesn't really have a side all the time. I mean, I know what I feel is versus right or wrong, but I think a lot of things is about perspective. And I think right now it's just a lot of people coming in real time face to face with the tragedies that befall history. So I am the most hated of all. Wouldn't you be telling me this shit? Because I'm on the sidelines going, I understand why you feel this way. But I also understand how they feel. Well, I don't understand how they feel. I just know that I'm sure their feelings, I know from that documentary I watched. And then there's a lot of racism involved as well. You know, it's a lot of immigration because that's also an issue. You know, we always want to look at it in a black and white fashion. It's not a black and white issue. I used to think it was a black and white issue, and I thought I knew how I felt about it. And then the more I started to educate myself on not just the stories that was an echo chamber of what I thought, but start listening to the other stories and really got some, like, I can't just sit here. I know how I want to be, but I can also understand what is happening. It's always a lot of cognitive dissonance, which is, you know, is my favorite word. Back to the show. I think Jimmy is a bookie because it was Sweeps that was talking to the Fock about the baseball story. And then he said he used to put money on him. So I'm thinking, okay, that's the first time I thought in my brain, what illegal activity could Jimmy do? I couldn't figure it out. And a bookie makes total sense. That's the old school Italian, is that supposed to be Italian? Type of deal where you would know everybody. It's kind of not legal, but it's rather accepted. They probably do like little shady deals for people. Gosh, only knows. As far as why the other two left, I bet after Mikey died, they couldn't afford to pay them. I mean, when Carmi showed up, it looked really bad. And the rest of them seemed to be here because they had nowhere else to go. I have never had an Italian beef. I want to get one, but no, I will be getting that motherfucker dry because I do not like soggy bread. It's the reason why I don't like French toast. Never liked it. Don't like soggy bread. That's starts to taste like something your mom chewed up for you and stuffed in your mouth as a child. That lovely description. If you want to send feedback on the next episode, thank you for letting me know. And now you're like 10, 9 episodes. And I'm like, what the fuck? Am I really this off? Thought I saw 10 earlier, but maybe I just assumed that said 10 because I saw 9. Yeah, no, it is 10 episodes. Yep, it's 10 episodes. So, let me see what season 2 was. Season 2 was 10. Mm-hmm. And it was season 1 that was 8. I knew one of them was 8. So yeah, we have 2 more to go. Well, technically 3 more to go, but we will be doing one more this week, which will be out tomorrow. If you want to send feedback, blackgirlcouch@gmail.com. You can leave a comment below. My social media will be there as well. Like, share, subscribe. Until the next time, peace, hair grease, and blacker magic.